good morning. So it's my pleasure to chair this keynote on the second day, and not tomorrow after the gala dinner. We welcome Martin Hamilton from JISC in UK, and he's working, channeling new ideas, he's building partnership and bring them to fruition. But you may not make me ease for pronouncing English. And he's really interested in social implication of ubiquitous robotics and artificial intelligence. Thank you, Martin.
Thank you. Could we have a round of applause, actually? Yes, I gave him some very hard words. So, hello. Before I start, I've been thinking of doing a thing which you don't have to participate in, but it might be kind of fun, just to do a 360 selfie of the audience. So, if you're up for this, then you wave your arms in the air when I count to three. If you don't want me to post your picture on Twitter later on, just kind of hide behind your arms, okay? So, one, two, three, woo! Hey, good stuff. Thank you. So, hopefully that will turn out. So, I'm going to talk about really three things today, which are all to do with digital skills and the challenges that some of the new technologies that are coming along right now present for our learners, but for our staff and for our institutions. But before I do that, I wanted to say a couple of words about who we are and where I personally am coming from. So I think probably quite a few of you know JISC already as the NREM in the UK. We run the Janet Network, we run EduRem in the UK, and we're a founding partner of the Shibboleth Consortium. Folk who come to EUNIS probably also heard quite a bit about our work on digital capability, and it's really that kind of angle that I'm going to pick up for you today. So it's not going to be so much about networking, wireless, internet connectivity. So if you came looking for that, I'm afraid you've come to the wrong talk. What we've been doing in Europe is also very interesting to me. So through the projects like OpenAir, new EU Open Science Plan pilot. And guess what? Actually, we're hiring. So if any of you would like to come and join us to work on those European projects, we are still European, and Brexit might be happening, but for now we're still European, and we'd love to work with you. So my own role in all of this is to look out for new technologies, to look out for new trends, and try and build partnerships that will help us to bring them to fruition, so as we heard in the introduction. So well done for tackling those very awkward words. If you look at the abstract for this talk, really there are three things. So we said there are near future careers, there are new kinds of jobs, there are new vocations that people will have. This presents us with a challenge, because some of these are actually not so far in the future at all. And in a moment you'll see some examples. So how do we equip today's learners for this world of tomorrow, which is really coming very fast? Life comes at you fast. And most importantly of all for me, not everyone has a place in this new world. Not everyone who has a job right now will still have one in the future. And there are an awful lot of people who simply don't have their foot on the ladder. So if they're going to thrive in this new world, how can we help them? So those are my three things today. So first off, let's look at some near future careers. And if you can look at this and you might say, you know, okay, asteroid mines, really? We'll come back to that. Here's some jobs for DNA editors. I just took one jobs board here, so this is the LinkedIn jobs board. There are a lot of jobs for DNA editors. I found hundreds of jobs already for DNA editors. If you search for CRISPR, C-R-I-S-E-R, this is the DNA editing technique that's really taken off in the last couple of years. DNA editor is a job right now. How many of our institutions are training people to be EMA editors? Actually, there are quite a few. It's becoming a vocation, it's becoming a career, it's becoming something that you can get a qualification in. So, good. What about drone engineers? Actually, yeah, drone engineer is a job. So, you probably can't make out in small print here. This is a jobs board where there are over 300 jobs for drone engineers. And they're quite well paid. So if you take a look, these salaries are in dollars. Here's 56 jobs which pay over $125,000. This is a pretty good salary if you live in the States. So this is the thing. This is a real job right now. And again, I think we can ask ourselves, of our institutions, of our staff, and how well are we responding to some of these things? These are real, these are happening right now. And my favourite, asteroid mining. So this is a job, actually. No one is mining asteroids yet, but there are companies like this one, Planetary Resources, who are actively gearing up to do that. So it will be very soon, actually, that the asteroid miners that they are hiring, that is an apply now button. This is to apply to become an asteroid miner as a career. So think about that. How many of our institutions, I mean our courses, etc., are preparing people for that career? Maybe not so many. So it's very interesting to see, but how is this even possible? How is this even possible? Let's watch a video. Maybe some of you have seen this already. It's a very short video. It's speeded up a little bit. So who knows what this is? Put your hand up if you know what it is. Yeah, okay, so a couple of you have clearly seen this already. This is SpaceX with their reusable rocket launchers. So they have a rocket which is the size of a 20-story building. We just watched it fly all the way down from space and land on a little tiny object. And that little tiny object is a ship. Okay, so we saw that rocket, which is at the height of a 20-story building, come all the way down from space and land. So it could fly again. And why is that a big deal? It's a big deal because that rocket cost $100 million. So that's a $100 million rocket. Historically, we've flown it up into space and boom, it's gone. And the rocket would burn up on re-entry or it would just fly off into the infinite open space. When you look at that rocket, it doesn't look very big, but you might just be able to make out some little tiny dots here. Those are people. That rocket actually is pretty big. It can get quite a lot of payload up into space. It will very soon have up to five or six astronauts in a crew capsule. So far, they've only been using this technology to send cargo into space. So next year, it will carry people. And in the future, this is an artist's impression, this rather big rocket will be the big brother of this one. So this is the one we have already. And this one, the Interplanetary Transport System, is the one that SpaceX are building to send people to Mars. So you know we said DNA editor? Well, it's kind of becoming a vocation, it's becoming a career. Drone engineer, yeah, okay. Those are real things, and in some places you can take a course that will help you to become one of those things. Asteroid miners, Martian colonists. This might seem incredibly far-fetched. This might seem like something that will not happen in our lifetimes. But don't be surprised if maybe about 10 years from now, we do actually have quite a lot of people living in space. That $100 million rocket, if you can fly it again, the conservative estimate right now is it will cost $1 million, maybe a bit less, to refurbish it, refuel it, and fly it again. That's 1% of the cost right now. So right now, you pay your $100 million, it's all gone. In the future, you get to keep 99 million and use it again and again. So this will make space travel very, very cheap compared with how it is now. And that, I think, will be quite transformational. So, okay, we talked about some careers which we're starting to see. And hey, most universities don't offer a course on DNA editing. Most universities don't offer a course on drone engineering. You might find something, maybe it's an option in a final year module or a degree, something like that. But we have lots of learners right now who are very interested in these new technologies. So how can we kind of bridge the gap? We've been doing some work as part of our digital capability program, and you can find a whole load of resources here at ji.sc/developing-digicap. I'll tweet a link to that later on, but do by all means do a photo. Quite a lot of resources there, which are all about how we come to terms with what digital means for us as staff, as administrators, as lecturers, as students. How can we make the most of the potential of digital technology? So we've got a load of resources out there which we'd love for you guys to pick up and use. So do have a look. And if you reuse them, let me know. They're all openly licensed, so we'd love to see what you do with them. That's the sales pitch over. If you are one of those students, maybe you're looking at something like self-driving cars. That's another near-future career, is working in self-driving cars. Maybe you thought, okay, I'd like to be a self-driving car engineer. I'm going to make self-driving cars. Here's a thing which I thought was really fascinating. This is September of last year. Udacity, the online course provider, said, hey, a lot of people are interested in this. We'll team up with, and they didn't team up with the university. There are no universities in this. They teamed up with people like Mercedes, BMW, McLaren F1, so they're maybe a self-driving Formula One in the near future. And they said, well, let's try this out. Let's have a course, an online course, where people can learn to be a self-driving car engineer. It's not free, by the way. This isn't a MOOC in the traditional sense. It costs $2,500. It takes you several months to do this. And you're supported by a mentor. And there is the interesting thing. They can only take up a cohort of around 250 students because they need the human mentor for those students to work with. So somebody who works in the automotive industry, somebody who can say, okay, this is good, and let's talk about this. This bit isn't quite right. So those mentors, actually, they're essential to making this work, but they also create some challenges for scaling it. But for you guys, this is an opportunity, right? So how many people are interested in being self-driving car engineers? It turns out quite a few. Also, they're everywhere. So they're not, you know, in Munster, Westphalia, they're not in Europe, necessarily. And in that tweet, this is taken, I think, 24 hours after they posted the details of this course. 20,000 people have already said, yeah, me, I'm to do this. A couple of days later, it was 30,000. And remember, they can only take 250 people. Wouldn't it be good if there were lots of other places that you could go to learn to be a self-driving car engineer? But this is a challenge, I think, for our institutions, because all of us in any large organization, we work to multi-year plans and strategies. Maybe we have a 5-year plan or a 10-year strategy. If something like this comes along, it's quite hard to say, we must divert lots of resource into this, or we must make some new resource to work on. But there is quite a lot that you can do if you are an independently minded student and you want to get to grips with this. And I think it's really interesting to see the trajectory from the technologies which have been commercialized and have been packaged up for what you can do as an individual. So here's the thing. There's a picture of a Tesla electric car here. The Tesla electric cars have this self-driving feature called autopilot. And they've already sold nearly 100,000 cars equipped with autopilot. Autopilot is the thing that will let the car take over from you. So you can push a button and say, okay, you do the driving. The car can't drive everywhere. It'll probably be okay on the autobahn, on the freeway, on the motorway. Maybe not so good in a busy city centre. But Tesla owners have already driven over 140 million miles on autopilot. Every time they drive the car on autopilot, they're training the car to drive itself a little bit better. So every time a cat runs out of that car and slam the brakes on, the car is just learning. And I don't know that that's a cat exactly, but this happened, and this is what to do if it happens again. And you might not necessarily be completely sure about that when it's only happened a few times. When it's happened a few hundred times, so maybe you can say, yeah, we're pretty sure about this, actually. And this is the model that underpins a lot of what we call artificial intelligence right now. It's kind of pattern recognition, really, on a large scale. And there's that little Google car. And we know now that Google probably won't ever make a Google car, which I think is a real shame. Does anybody actually want this? I'd love to buy one of these. Put your hand up if you'd like to buy one. There's only a few. I'm in a minority. Okay. So the other thing that was very interesting was that Uber came along and they said, well, do you know what? We feel a little bit threatened because we think that in the future people won't own cars. When the car can drive itself, everyone who wants a car will just go beep on their app, on their phone, the car will light up. Ah, that's our business model. So Uber did an incredible thing. You know, I was talking about how institutions find it difficult to pivot. Well, Uber said, actually, we want to have a fleet of self-driving cars. So going from, we have no assets, we are a company without any assets at all, like Airbnb, all of a sudden, Uber said, actually, we want to have our own fleet of self-driving cars. What's very interesting there is they hired a team from US universities, so they hired the entire autonomous vehicle team, I think it was from Michigan. And that guy posting on Twitter is the lead engineer from the team. So another very interesting thing for me is actually you can talk to this guy. So if you're a student, you're an independent learner, you're very interested in this, you can actually talk to this guy. You can just drop him a line, you can tweet him, and you know, he might reply to you. That's something that's only really become possible in the last few years. But this is incredible. It's incredible to think how you could make that connection. Well, we talked about the AI learn. Let's have a look at what that actually looks like. So this is an AI, as we've taken to calling them. It's not really intelligent. It's a machine learning model. It's a neural network. But for the sake of simplicity, we've all taken AIs. What's it doing? Well, it's learning to play breakout. Maybe some of you played breakout in your youth. I've got the grey hairs now. I remember playing it as a kid. And it doesn't really know how to play breakout. It just knows it can move the paddle. And maybe it's got a strategy, which is to make the game last as long as possible. Well, it's been playing for a while. Notice 600 games. It figures out that it can take this route over on the side. And now, DeepMind, this is Google's DeepMind AI, will always win a breakout. Don't ever bother trying to play against DeepMind because it will whoop your ass. It knows how to win a breakout. And this is the thing, they've been working it through. In fact, they've been working DeepMind through a vast number of old video games which people have posted as a way of training it to do stuff. So it has now learned how to always win a breakout. So we think that we're going to train the AI on playing video games. Well, video games are all very well, much like a video game, like a bee, when we're actually trying to drive a real car around a real town or city where there are real people you might find comfortable. I'm not going to play you all with this. Actually, it doesn't look that different to a video game. In fact, if you're playing video games like me, back at the turn of the 90s, then maybe you played a lot of games that actually did look like that. So that's what the car sees. But if I want to learn about this, I can't really just kind of borrow a self-driving car. That's a hard thing to do. What I can do is I can take something like this. So this is a nice little project that someone did. It's called Edges to Cats. And Edges to Cats is a little bit further on in machine learning and neural networks. So Edges to Cats is an example of a generative adversarial network, which is where you pit two neural networks against each other. One of them knows cats. It's been trained. Remember the training that we saw with Breakout? It's been trained to recognize cats. The other one has no idea what a cat is, but it's been told to create a picture. And what you can do in this app is you can draw a little sketch of your kind of ideal cat. It will take the edges of your sketch and try and make a cat based on them. So the generative neural network, the one that creates the picture, sends its picture to the recognizing one, and the recognizing one says, "Bah. Not a cat." Try again. The generating one tries again and tries again until the recognizing one says, "Yeah, okay, that'll do. Yeah, that's pretty cat-like. It's maybe 75% cat, but we can kind of recognize that there's a cat there." If you draw a monster, hey! You get a cat monster, which has to be a bit of the tweeting. So there's our cat monster. But actually, there's a deeper thing here, which is you might have noticed the archive.org link there. This is an academic paper. It's open access. The code is open source, and it's on GitHub. And you run it on Google's open source machine learning platform, which is called TensorFlow. So wind all the way back to the institution saying, look, new careers, jobs, new professions. How do we kind of shift our emphasis, how do I shift our focus? If I'm an independent learner, I don't necessarily care. I can just go up and download this. And I can learn not just how to use neural networks to recognize things, remember what the self-driving car was doing, but also I can use them to make things. And that's really quite profound. I didn't need an institution. I didn't need a university at all. Any of this. It just so happens that these outputs are part of the academic literature because of open access. So these things are out there for me as an independent learner to explore. And this is where I think it's particularly interesting. We've had a few talks at EUNIS about learning analytics. I think it's really interesting to think about how machine learning and learning analytics can come together. Hopefully in productive ways, but also they could be used in ways which would be perhaps quite unhelpful and quite prejudicial to the individual. So right now, with learning analytics, we're kind of at around about here, or maybe here. We're using learning analytics to monitor things like people dropping out of lectures, say, have you not been to lectures recently? Maybe you've not been to your library for a while. Okay, we need to stage an intervention, and you know this is all very powerful stuff. We don't know why. And if that intervention is not thoughtful, then it could be quite unhelpful. I can imagine that we have a bereavement in your family, someone has died, and you get an automated message that says, hey, you've not been to lectures recently, not so good. So we need to use these things thoughtfully. Just we think that there's kind of a trajectory from that kind of rudimentary use of analytics right through to kind of institutional efficiency. No one wants to book this lecture period. Why is that? And maybe if we can see some patterns, we can figure out why and we can do something about it. All the way up to, and this is probably the really contentious one, actually, if we use these techniques, if we use them to say, hey, we don't know exactly why, but you look like somebody who maybe needs to do a little bit more work on a particular area of your course. Let's say you're learning to be that self-driving car engineer, but you're advanced mathematics. You're not doing so well at the tests. You need to do a little bit more work on that. So maybe there's a machine learning model. Maybe there's an AI that acts as a coach and a mentor to you. And I'm saying this looking at an enormous lecture theatre. The other day I was talking to somebody who's building a lecture theatre for 500 students. So imagine being the lecturer, studying, and have 500 students. I mean, I guess that's probably about twice the size of this room, all spread out in front of you. How can you individually support all those students? It's going to be a real challenge. So maybe we can use some of these techniques to do that kind of boosting and reinforcement of elements of the curriculum. But there is a problem. There is a problem with this. Assuming even that we can do it thoughtfully, we've potentially reached a point where everybody has a unique path through the curriculum. No two people have taken exactly the same course. That makes it very hard to do feedback. It makes it very hard to evaluate the course. What does it mean when everyone has almost a unique and personal interpretation of the course? And so I think these are going to be very big questions for us. We've been doing a little bit of work in this area through our startups competition, and I picked out an example here of a firm that we're working with, Wildfire Learning, which is actually using AI, it's using machine learning technology, to generate e-learning material. So essentially, if you had a learning designer sat next to you who could say, okay, this is how to lay your stuff out, this is how to pace it, this is how to develop the raw material that you have into a course. Well, that would be great, but a lot of our teaching staff don't have that. So maybe we can use machine learning to give them a little bit of help. So have a look at that, Wildfire Learning. We think it's very interesting, and you know, maybe some of you would like to try it out. Okay, so I'm kind of winding down now, but I'm conscious that what I've been talking about is, it's pretty upbeat on the whole. And you know, if you watch Silicon Valley CEOs, of course it's always good news. There's never any bad news. In Silicon Valley, the sun always shines. But actually, for a lot of people, this is maybe not so good. So here's a little series of thoughts about robots, which I think crystallized this quite nicely. So. Here's the Pepper robot. Has anybody seen Pepper in real life? Ah, good, so there's a couple of you. Yeah, so Pepper is the kind of robot that maybe you pictured when you were a kid. You thought the robots would kind of look humanoid, you would be able to talk to them. They would be able to understand you and talk back to you. Pepper can do that, but only up to a point. Pepper has a script. And there's a job actually there, it's writing a script for the robot. That is another career, robot script editor. Already 10,000 of those robots have been sold, mostly in Japan. So in Japan, SoftBank, who own the robot, have Pepper in all the mobile phone stores, the Japanese big mobile phone company. Nestle have managed to put them into their high-end coffee pod shops. You'll start to see Pepper in hotels, in airport concourses, high-end shopping malls, and places like that. Right now, it's still mostly in Japan, but it's starting to find its way out. Pepper actually has been already taking a lot of people's jobs, in fact, because there were people who had the job that Pepper has mostly taken so far, which is to be the greeter. You come into the shop and someone says to you, hey, how are you doing? Is your mobile phone contract due for renewal? We should talk about that. We have some good deals. So Deborah has already replaced a lot of those people. In Japan, there is even a SoftBank store which is staffed entirely by robots. So they're all pepper, which could be a bit confusing. What does that actually mean? What's it like? I won't play you all of this again because we don't have enough time, but let's watch a little bit of pepper in action. So that's Pepper in real life, and it is a very interactive thing you feel when you're actually having a conversation with it. If you look at the code which drives Pepper, it is very traditionally computer code. It is kind of like a flowchart, and there are branch points, and listen for the human to say something, is it one of the following phrases that I'm expecting? So it gives the appearance of intelligence, it gives the appearance of understanding you. Maybe a little bit misleading. Here's another robot, and this is called Betty. And this gives me a real pause for thought. Why do we have to give robots a gender? It feels quite strange. Why does it have to be female? So Betty works for Amazon now. Amazon bought the company. This is from just before Amazon bought the company. You ever wonder what happens when you press that buy now button?
You've clicked buy, and your online purchase is complete. Betty's
work
is just beginning.
Betty's just waking up now to go and find the shelf that has your purchase on it.
Behind every online store is a warehouse full of merchandise. One is Quiet Logistics, where there are 1.5 million items stored. It's BettyBot's job to retrieve your purchase, and she can do this faster and more accurately than any human ever could. When you buy something, your order enters the EVA database. The software locates the robot closest to your item and directs her to retrieve it.
So I'll stop it there, but you know, isn't that fascinating? We don't really tend to visit internet store warehouses. It's not the place that most of us have any experience of. Betty lives in something called the human exclusion zone. Human beings aren't allowed in there. And there's a reason for that, and that's because all those robots scurry around quite quickly. If they're not carrying a shelf to the human packers, then the robots scoot underneath the rows of shelving, so they're very efficient. Once upon a time, that was a job. That's a job that has already been impacted by the spread of robotics. And you'll see the number down there. Amazon has over 45,000 robots working in its warehouses right now. That's something like 12% of Amazon's workforce is already robots, which actually is something that should give you maybe pause for thought. This isn't something that's in day-to-day use right now, but if you Google Amazon Picking Challenge, what you'll see is that there are a whole bunch of robotics and artificial intelligence teams at universities who are competing to design a robot arm and the software that drives it, which will do the bit that the humans still do. Do you remember the human exclusion zone is around a little cage, which is where the humans pick the items off the shelving, put them in a box, send to you the consumer. The picking challenge is all about picking things which are very fragile, or maybe they're very awkwardly shaped, maybe they're very heavy. They have all sorts of characteristics which mean that you have to treat each one differently and specially. So when they crack this, maybe they don't need the humans in the cage anymore. So So maybe the entire warehouse is crewed by robots, and maybe with one or two people who every now and then have to press the big stop button and go and fix something. So that's, for me, that's really fascinating to see, because that affects an awful lot of people, but not nearly as many people as the self-driving cars. So you know, when we were looking at self-driving cars, actually, in the States there are 3.5 million truck drivers. And one of the biggest self-driving vehicle startups is a company called Otto, which makes self-driving trucks. So 3.5 million people drive a truck for a living right now in the States. In the UK we have 370,000 taxi drivers. If those self-driving cars displace those jobs, well, that has a real effect on people. It has an effect on society, it has an effect on the economy, and there are all kinds of effects. But, you know, that's a little bit dystopian, so I thought, hey, here's a nice, more uplifting note. So here's Jeff Bezos, Amazon CEO, he's the little tiny person there inside the robot. So whilst on one hand we're talking about robots as things which will displace jobs or create new jobs, on the other hand, some of those new jobs may be things that we just really thought about in the past. So Jeff's robot there, he sees being an essential part of establishing a human presence on Mars. So these are people who think big. Every self-respecting billionaire right now seems to have their own space program, and a lot of them are heading for Mars. But what about those displaced people? We have a real problem here. It's a problem for people who have a career which is being slowly erased by technology, but it's also a huge problem for people who are just young people who are just starting to establish themselves. What will we do? One possibility is this idea called basic income, where you just get a stipend, you get paid simply for existing, whether or not you have a job. And if you're able to make a contribution to society, you're able to function in society. Most societies are capitalistic, so you need some capital. But that doesn't give you a sense of purpose. What do you get out of bed in the morning thinking if you don't have a job, if you don't have a vocation? What are you left with? Now, we as humans, we have a deep-seated need for a purpose. We need to have a goal. We need to have a vision to work towards. So, if we don't have that vision, or maybe some kind of negative thoughts will take hold. We've seen some terrible events in the world in recent weeks. Maybe some of those actually can really be traced back to people who are seeing that there is nothing for them. Maybe we'll see a rise in all kinds of terrorism and violent crime simply because people don't have that higher purpose. And then, just thinking about the implications of technology in our daily lives now, I think it's really telling that in China, 86% of high school kids now wear glasses. So, is that because in China there is a culture of working very hard to succeed academically? Is it because of airborne pollution, or of other places where it's dangerous to spend too much time outside? Is it a consequence of screen time? Because we're spending so much time looking at screens. But all of these things are quite negative. I don't think it is all negative. I think these are all problems, these are all challenges for us. But I think that there are also a whole lot of opportunities. And that challenge, ultimately, is whether the two will balance each other out. And I think it's incumbent upon us as educators to try and make sure that they do, and to try and influence policymakers to make sure that those displaced people are helped and supported and not left behind. So how can we do that? One of the things that we can do is to help people to reskill, to help people to learn one of those new professions, one of those new trades. Let's say you want to learn to be a self-driving car engineer. We've seen how you go on and you learn how to do that yourself. How can we in our institutions help people to do that? And I think there are quite a lot of ways. the same time, there are a billion people who are just coming online. Those people are all desperate for education. And this is something that we take for granted, but in a lot of those countries where people are just coming online, just discovering the internet, there's a real thirst for knowledge. People want to improve their life chances, improve their prospects. And then the thing which is probably on a lot of people's minds today, of course, is Brexit. If you are UK national, I don't know about you guys, if you're thinking about Brexit at all. Back in the UK, we're thinking about it quite a lot, because if one party is elected, in particular, then we may leave the EU with no transitional deals, no special arrangements, and good luck, UK. But here's the thing, this is an Estonian e-residency card, so I got one of these last year. And this makes me maybe 10% Estonian. I can set up a business in Estonia, I can trade in euros, my business is EU resident. We have this concept of nation states and borders and boundaries, but the technology doesn't tend to respect them. And actually there's an awful lot that we can do with technology to address some of these problems that doesn't rely on policymakers saying you have permission to do this. We don't actually necessarily need to seek permission. But at the beginning I said I thought it was a little bit hard sometimes for institutions to change their focus, change their direction, particularly when events are coming at you fast. And here's a nice diagram. This is from a strategist called Simon Wardley. Simon suggests that really there are three kinds of person in an organisation. There are the town planners. These are the people who keep the strategy, they keep the five-year plan, they produce the budget submission, they check the KPIs. Over here, there are the pioneers. These are the people who will come along with a radical new technology. Maybe it's the DNA edit, maybe it's the autonomous vehicles. And in the middle is a third group that he calls settlers. And I find this model very, very powerful, because if you take the other two, and we all know that those other two groups exist, if you take the other two, they find it very difficult to work together. They have no common language, they have no common vision, they have no common grounds. The settlers, the middle group, are the group that takes the radical new idea, maybe tests it a little bit, prototypes it, fixes it up a little bit, comes back to the innovator and says, hey, you know, this is great, but it won't really work unless. And I think that at events like this, we have a lot of settlers. And I would encourage you to think of yourselves that way. You have sight of lots of new stuff which most of your peers won't have seen. And you can come back to them and you can say, look, here is an interesting thing. Let's talk about what we can do with this. So think of yourself as a settler. Don't think of yourself as a town planner. You may think of yourself as a pioneer, in which case, go for it. I wanted to end with one other thing. We talked earlier on about how open access, open source, open data, the whole open access to teaching and learning research outputs potentially is hugely transformational. How do we reach that next billion learners? How do we give opportunities to people who are being pushed out of their current career, their current job by these new technologies? I think that maybe, actually, this is part of a wider cultural shift towards open practices. And I've just put a little report out about this, so you can go to gisco.uk/reports, and you'll see it pop up there. We call it open by default. And that is all I'm going to say about open practices, because Sheila is going to do a whole talk for you now, all about it. So that's been me. I hope that there's been one or two interesting things in there for you, maybe something that you've never seen before, something that you've never seen before.